SEL revision, everybody knows that it can be a big challenge in our field and during our daily activity, and that's why we put this topic on the program, because not only for the topic itself, but also for the discussion with this big international expert, and it can be really a challenge. But if we go back to the primary ACL reconstruction, just to remind you that, but probably everybody knows that, but it's important to remind that the success of an ACL reconstruction is based on the patient selection, preoperative patient preparation, of course, other ligament and meniscal injuries, operative technique, of course, but not only, because the postoperative rehabilitation is very important. And if we look at the result in the literature today, in 2010, of primary ACL reconstruction, it's between 75%, it's a little bit severe, but if we look at all the literature, the good and excellent results are between 75% and 90%. In the other hand, it means that between 10% and 25% are unsatisfactory results. Of course, all the unsatisfactory result doesn't lead to a revision. But it's important to know that it's impossible, I mean, to have less than 10% of unsatisfactory results, so it means we must manage that now. If we look at this statistic, compare France and the USA, for example, between 1996 and 2006, you see that, for example, in France, this is about the same percentage between France and the USA, so the same habits, I mean, the percentage of revision in 1996 was 13%, and you see that in 2006, 20% of revision. So it means now it's really not only a challenge, it's a daily activity for a surgeon, an orthopedic surgeon. So in 2010, we can imagine that it's more than 20%. Not sure, not anymore. We don't have any statistic right now, but we can say approximately that when an orthopedic surgeon does an ACL reconstruction, he can do up to 20% of case he does a revision. So it's really a part of our activity, and we are not only managing the primary reconstruction. But what is exactly a failure? Because it's quite difficult, and the real definition of failure is not still precise, and there is no big consensus. We can say, anyway, we can say that it's a mix between an instability, remaining instability, pain, increased laxity, and diminution of mobility. And usually it's a mix with different combination between these four things. What constitutes a failure? It can be an infection. It's a different way of failure, but this is a failure. A stiffness, muscular deficiency, pain, failure to return to sport for different reasons. But in fact, and this is what we are interested in today, in most of the case, it's due to a graft deficiency, and it leads to instability. And I will take as an example, but we have a lot now in the literature, but we'll take this 2006 study in the French Arthroscopic Society, where directed by Philippe Néret and Philippe Colombet, it was a multicentric study. And, you know, we had 293, almost 300 cases of ACL revision. And what we discovered, what we showed during this multicentric study, that in almost 50%, I saw John Berfig talk about 60%, maybe, but almost minimum of 50% of the case, it's a technical mistake, and mostly tunnel positioning. So it means there is really a technical problem, and you see that when we talk about surgery between surgeons, we talk always about technical, not only technical, but technical issues are really a problem. It's bad news, because in more than 50% of the case, the surgeon is responsible for the failure, so we don't like that. But in other way, it's a good news because it can be improved with a technique. If it is only technique, it can be improved. If we look at the clinical result of this symposium, and we can find the same result, approximately the same result in the literature, surprisingly, there is a low rate of complication. But the functional core goes from 60 to only 73 in AKDC score, and only one for three are grade A. The average KT1000 laxity is not huge because it's only 3 millimeters. But what is very interesting is the functional score. And if we look at all the literature and the main article, we can definitely say that the result of ACL reconstruction are lower than those of primary surgery. It's not surprising, but it's good to show it and to prove it scientifically. So this symposium did a meta-analysis, and we see that the score of the 75 IKDC is due to different factor, and it's a global loss of result in front of primary ACL reconstruction. In this study, we did two studies, a prospective study and a retrospective study. And it appeared that in the prospective study, the global IKDC was 84% in comparison with the 72%. And the laxity increase, we can show that the laxity increase with the time. Okay. It's a comparison between pro and retro, of course, but if we look at the long-term follow-up of these knees, we can see that in 56%, we had a degenerative change, and it increased with the time. Probably is due to the fact that despite the recommendations, even in this new study, I mean a modern study, we had 66% of meniscectomy, and probably we can discuss about that in the same time with the meniscus session. So save the meniscus is a message definitively. And we see that the influence of the meniscectomy, if we compare a group with total meniscectomy versus normal meniscus, we can see that even for the AKDC, and not only for pain, and even for people shift, we had a big difference. And meniscectomy definitely is bad for global functional score and increase laxity. So based on this background, how can we manage, how are the principle of management of ACL failure? First of all, we must understand the failure in the process. There is three situations. It can be a bad result from the beginning, it can be a progressive bad result, and it can be a new trauma. And these conditions are not the same, it's very different. About the history, we must, it's absolutely mandatory and essential to start with the history to understand why we had a failure. When we manage a failure, the first thing before treating it is to understand why this patient had a failure. If we don't understand, if we treat it directly, it can be a mistake and a new failure at the end. So the past, what was the initial tier, the evolution, the present, which complaint? Is it pain? Is it stiffness? Is it instability? It's totally different and different to be managed. And the future, which sport plan and professional plan is different if you have treated recreational sportman or an athlete, football athlete, for example. The physical examination obviously is mandatory and essential. We always say that in our topics. But you know, this physical examination is important to assess type of laxity and the failure step. And sometimes it can bring different information. For example, we can find that a lateral or a posterolateral laxity was missed during the first trauma, and it can sometimes explain the failure of the ACL reconstruction itself. Imaging, of course, is very important, and we have first X-ray, don't forget the X-ray, and MRI, and sometimes CT scan or ultra CT scan to assess the bone loss. During the imaging with the different this different assessment, we have to assess the tunnel first, of course, the cartilage status, the meniscus status, hardware and fixation device in the knee, the tibial slope. Don't forget the tibial slope and the tendon and the muscles. So if we only see the tunnels or the cartilage, it's not enough. We really have to do a complete assessment, because if you have a big posterior tibial slope or a meniscus, an important meniscus lesion, or cartilage, of course, the treatment can be really different. We know that we have different criteria to assess tunnel positioning. No one is perfect, but we have different consensus. We have a consensus about the right position of the tunnels, and it can be measured and assessed and just on the X-ray before the MRI. So the improper graft placement is one of the most frequent cause of ACL revision and failure. In 80%, it's in femoral, on the femoral side. In 20%, it's on the tibial side. If the femoral tunnel is too anterior, the graft is too constrained in flexion, so it leads in failure. If the femoral tunnel is too posterior, it can be a loss of fixation. So this must be assessed first on the X-ray and then on MRI or the CT scan. Tibial, if the tibial tunnel is too anterior, everybody knows that we can have an impingement and it can lead to a loss of extension and the graft rupture. And if the tibial tunnel is really too posterior, it can lead to a laxity, because the graft is not able to fight against the anterior draw. So we can see some example here, and probably the fact that now we do double bundle ACL reconstruction, probably we have to modify our criteria, our landmarks, and I mean our way to assess, because it's not so easy to see if the tunnels are in the right position. With one tunnel, it's not so easy. With two tunnels, we can understand that it can be more difficult. Sometimes it's the tunnel is too anterior. Here are some examples. This is, you see, you know that we draw the line on the Blumenzeit and on the roof of the notch. And if the tunnel is anterior to this line, it must be posterior to this line. We can conclude that it's too anterior, and we can imagine the way and the position of the graft, and we can see that on this draw, that the impingement can lead to a graft failure. Sometimes it's surprising, this one less surprising, but obviously if you cannot see the tunnel, if there is no big tunnel, for example, for small graft, the hardware can show you and can give you an idea where the tunnel is positioned. The femoral tunnel is sometimes too anterior, and it's probably the most frequent abnormality. You see here that the tunnel must be posterior to on this part, close to the posterior wall. In this case, it's in the middle. If you don't see the tunnel itself, you can think that if the screw interference metallic screw is here, it means the graft is here, so it's too anterior, and sometimes it's huge, and we have all in our computers amazing X-ray and MRI example. Sometimes it's different. You can, and so you need it cannot be seen on the X-ray. You can see on the CT scan that we can have an impingement in the notch, in the notch. It's not very frequent. And sometimes it's a combined problem, and we see that this surgery was maybe a nightmare or maybe something difficult, and it leads to an impingement not with the ACL but with the screw itself. Quite surprising. And this case, you know, apparently if you see that quickly, we can see that, okay, it's not too bad, but in fact, you know, don't forget that an ACL an ACL ligament must not be in this condyle, but in this one. And Matteo showed you. Yeah, it's a real. It's not a Photoshop image. It's a real case. But everybody has this kind of example now, unfortunately. The tibial slope is less known, because probably some people didn't think that we have to do something, but you know, the Lyon school push and describe the effect of the tibial slope on the ACL anterior tibial draw and on the ACL constraint. And if we have a huge posterior slope, probably sometimes it can explain some sort of failures. And if we don't treat the, and if we don't correct this tibial slope, it can lead to a failure or to a new failure if you do a revision. And this one is huge. You know, you see that this patient had an osteotomy in the same time than the ACL reconstruction. And this is the next topic. And you see, it's not so easy. And we can see that during the osteotomy, the surgeon made a tibial slope. And it's a mistake, but it's not a big mistake because sometimes it's not so easy to control the slope of the tibia. So it can happen. And the CT scan probably is the best imaging to assess the bone loss, because sometimes it's huge, probably more with artificial ligament or some kind of reinforcing ligament. But you have to first, before the surgery, to assess this bone loss, because you can understand that the possibility of a fixation of the new ligament will be very difficult and challenging if you don't know previously that you have a bone loss. And in this case, probably there is an indication for a graft in one time or two steps. It's another discussion, but it must be assessed at the beginning. So which graph can we use in the ACL revision? It can be allograft. We don't have a big experience about that. We know that the advantage is to avoid any harvesting from the patient itself. We know that the results are not the same, that we can have some disease transmission, but it's a method. The BTB, if it was hamstring previously, the hamstrings, if it was BTB previously, some people can use we can use a PTB again after 18 months, usually. And the quadricep tendon is a good tendon also, less used by some teams. But we must not forget that this nice tendon can be very helpful in the case of revision. Some other people prefer to use the contralateral graph. So you see that you have a lot of possibilities. There is no real consensus. It depends on the teams and the experience of the surgeon. So the new surgery must take care about these six things. The incision first, for harvesting, of course, but also for removing some hardware sometimes. The graft removal often is easy. Sometimes you have problem with the bone block and the bone loss, not anymore, but previously we had some artificial ligament to manage with sometimes very big difficulty to remove it, and in the same time with bone loss. So hardware removal can be difficult and time-consuming, and so we have to assess this hardware on the probe imaging. We must prepare the gonancy. We must be cautious with the bone loss during removal, because sometimes you can create big holes and it can be a really nightmare to fix the new graft. And sometimes don't touch if you can, because if the screw is inside the bone, if you can make easily the tunnel in the posterior part of the femur, maybe sometimes it's better to let it. The only thing is to explain to the patient that he will keep and will you leave the screw for the X-ray. So the tunnel are sometimes easy to do because they are really in a bad position. So we can imagine that you change your orientation and you change the position of the tunnel. Sometimes it's not so easy because you are approximately in the same direction of the tunnel, so you can create a big hole and a big tunnel. And again, easy in this case, not so easy in this case, because you have to manage and different the trips and different techniques are described to change the orientation of the tunnel. Fortunately, we have different possibility in terms of a technique. If it was a transtibial, for example, we can use an extra anteromedial portal or out-in way to do the tunnel to avoid to reach the previous tunnel to have problem of fixation. So if we have to fill the hole, there is two possibilities, the bone graft, and usually it's better to use to do the bone graft in the first step. Some people use this technique in two steps. First, they restore the bone, and a few months after they do a new surgery. It's quite difficult for the patient, but sometimes you don't have any choice. Or you can use more fixation. For example, if you can use two screws, and if possible, absorbable screw, to fill the big tunnel and to fix in the same time the graft. Which fixation? It depends on the screw, it depends on the experience. Each type of fixation must be available in the operating theater. This is important, but usually I think people use a screw on the underbutton. Underbutton has the advantage to treat and to manage the tunnel with bone loss in the posterior part, so we can use a underbutton because the underbutton is against the cortex, and the screw, of course, it's a universal way to fix the tendon. And we must be ready to do an additional procedure. Osteotomy of deflection, for example, if there is a big tibial slop. Osteotomy of valgization, if there is already a degenerative change of the medial compartment. And for some teams and some screw, we can use, in addition, a lateral tenodesis. This, I think, it can be discussed during the discussion session because there is no proof, but some people prefer to add systematically a lateral tenodesis to treat the rotational instability. But with the new technique of double bundle, it can be discussed to restore and to treat this rotational instability. So in conclusion, the take-home message, it can be, not always, but it can be a difficult surgery, but this surgery must be assessed previously. The prevention is important, so it means put your tunnel on during the first ACL reconstruction in the right place. 80% of the surgeons perform less than the 50 ACL reconstruction per year, so it can be a problem if they are not used with this technique, and probably if they want to do ACL revision, maybe if they are not comfortable, they must ask to the more experimented colleague to do this surgery. The technical mistakes are unfortunately still frequent, and it means that education and training must be emphasized in this field. And this is an opportunity for me to inform you that some of people in this room are involved in this Congress. I have the honor to be one of the two scientific chairman program for this EFOST. You know, EFOST is a European Federation of National Association of Orthopedic Sports Traumatology. It will be held between the 25 and 27 November in 2010 in Brussels, Belgium. So come if you want. It will be interesting, not only for the ACL revision. Thank you very much.